Eric,
Okay.
you have the floor.
Hello, everybody. Good afternoon. So I'm the last one speaking before the lunch. So excuse me. I try to avoid picture of food. So nobody's moving. Okay. So let's just start with a small introduction. So I'm Eric Leblond. I'm working for Amstamus Networks. I'm one of the co-founders. On Amstamus Networks, we propose a solution that is intrusion detection, network detection and response based on Suricata, and we are strong believer in open source. So we propose quite a lot of open source solutions like SELX, which is an all integrated Suricata turnkey distribution that allows you to spawn Suricata ELK stack in 2 minutes. So if you want to sniff some traffic or just discover Suricata, that's one of the best ways to do it. And I will just jump to my introduction. So I'm one of the co-founders of Suricata, Amstamus Networks. I'm also one of the main developers of Suricata. And I'm currently board member of OISF, the foundation that is behind Suricata. So let's do a quick introduction for Suricata for the people that were on an island in the last 10 years or not doing network, which is maybe the case here. So Suricata was born in 2010. It's a big project now with more than 600,000 line of code. It's C and Rust. Rust had been introduced to procure some security because, like somebody, some people say, we are currently parsing the all the, okay, I'm trying to find not a curse word, everything, all the crap that is on internet. So we need to be resistant to almost anything. So being secure is a good thing because if you take down the detection, then you can act without being seen. So Suricata parse the live traffic and also work on PCAP file. So if you collect PCAP file by one way or another, you can use Suricata to analyze these files. And it produces JSON files. So we have one single output type that is really fully extended to get all the value of the fact that Suricata is understanding the application layer like HTTP, TLS, Modbus, MQTT, to just give a few one. One major thing about Suricata is that it's open, fully open source and community driven. So we have a strong community and a lot of good ideas that have been brought to Suricata over the years are coming from the community. And okay, I put in characteristic world famous because basically if you give me the name of a big company, I may not be allowed to tell you that they're using it, but the risk that they're using Suricata is really high. One of the specificities of Suricata is that it belongs to a foundation that is a non-profit foundation. And this is really interesting because it allows you to be sure that we are not going to be sold to the next big company. Google cannot buy the OISF, so the code will always be the property of Open Information Security Foundation, which will ensure that it will be always freely available because in the key document of the foundation, it says that it has to provide an open source IDS under the GPL license, so which is definitely bound to the status of the foundation. And one of the things that the OISF is doing is that it pays for the developers, so it's help financing the development, and it also organizes one conference where the CFP is open. It's called Suricon, and it's this year in November in Athens, Greece. Historically, Suricata has been started as a rewrite of Snort. So I think I've seen some Talos people leaving the show at the beginning. Maybe they don't want to know what we have done after that. One problem that we have, because we come as a, how do you call that, as a copycat of Snort at the beginning, is that we did use the language of Snort for the signature, and the language of Snort for signature is not really nice to read, and it's not easy to understand. So we did try to fix it over the time with some big feature and some improvement, but it's still a bit complicated to read. One, a network intrusion detection system is nothing without some good signature. So it's not because Proofpoint is one of the sponsors of this edition that I can say that they are providing two really good rule sets, which are ET Open and ET Pro. And if you have a little bit of money, I really think you should spend it on ET Pro because there is the coverage is really better in terms of detection. And Suricata is not bound to this, so you have a lot of different public sources that are available, and you can also interact with tools like MISP, the Malware Information Sharing Platform, to import some signature that can be published by some partner. One simple signature example, as you can see, you don't want to read that every day, but I will just want to mention a few things that are the evolution of what we had recently and where we're going to see after how we are using it. It's this metadata part here, where we have really interesting information about the scope of the signatures, and this information end up in the alert that are produced under the JSON format. So for instance, here you can see that we got something new that has been added by Proofpoint, which is the MITRE tactic ID, the MITRE tactic name. So you can just map directly the alerts with the MITRE framework. So it's quite interesting. And with regard to the match, for the one who are used to signature, one thing that we are doing since the last version of Suricata is using what we call sticky buffers. So the sticky buffers is a prefix where you see I put the context of all the match that are going to come to be the HTTP method. So here, Suricata parse the HTTP, analyze the HTTP, parse it in different fields, and then you can just do matches on this field instead of the old style of IDS where you kind of have a grep on the network traffic and you need to reconstruct the protocol yourself when writing the signature. So it's really easier like this. And it offers also some nice features that we are going to use later. And it's not just on HTTP, but you can also do that on TLS. So here TLS is not just looking at some field in the protocol, but really understanding the negotiation of a TLS on-check and finding some information there. Here we're just not looking at part of the packet, but reconstructing data based on the packet and proposing this data to the user. So that's a little difference. Now, the if format that we are using is the nickname for our JSON file. It's really easy to read because it's JSON, and it's really easy to ingest in any data lake like Splunk, Elasticsearch, or over NECM almost now. And the good thing is that we have got the same format for all events. So we have this format for alerts and this format also for protocol transaction. And it contains really all the fields that we can export. So it gives you the maximum information you can get from the engine. To give you an idea of what we can get in an alert, so I just took the first example, the Cobalt Strike, and here we can see here the metadata that we have, so you can find in the event the MITRE technique ID. So basically, you can just use this to do research and do mappings on interesting dashboard. It's not just an alert between this IP and this IP. You've got far more data, which allow you to classify really more interestingly the alert. And then it continues. You've got really a lot of metadata in these signatures. And then we have got the application layer metadata, where we get all the HTTP information inside the alert. So you don't need to get the PCAP to try to understand what did happen. You already have it already has been analyzed. So you can just look at all the parameters of the HTTP request. And it's really then easier and faster to analyze the event. So this capability of understanding the protocol is used to journalize protocol transaction. So independently of alert, for instance, here we got on the right a DNS log, so we can do passive DNS with Suricata, and it can be done with a lot of different protocols. I'll just give you a simple extract here that I will not read. And yes, I forgot to talk about Zeek. That is because there is a trend in the cybersecurity to say you need Suricata and Zeek. But if you don't want to lose time, just start with Suricata and then look at Zeek later. because there is a big overlap in the data. There is some other advanced feature. One is IP rep, which allows you to match on a long list of IP address or network. So the second one is Lua. You can do Lua scripting. So when you don't understand, when Suricata do not understand the protocol and you want to match on something a little bit advanced, you can just pre-filter and then trigger a Lua script to do the detection. So if you need to go deep down inside the packet, you can use this feature. That can be quite convenient. And you can also use Lua to do your own output. It's not really used a lot, but it can be quite powerful. And the last feature that I will cover more extensively, because we are at BotConf, is the dataset. So what is the dataset on Match? It's one of the new features of Suricata that is really interesting. So I introduced briefly before the sticky buffer, which allows you to match on metadata. And so basically the dataset is simple. It's just, I've got this metadata, like the HTTP user agent, like the HTTP host, and I want to match this on a big list that is stored in a file. So it's simple, but the fact that it's on any metadata that is available in the detection engine is quite powerful. For instance, here I've got two examples. One, I've got a list of official agents that are known in my and authorized in my company, but I can collect by some way. And I want to say, make me an alert if ever the HTTP user agent is not in the list of official agent. So that can be quite useful in one company. Another example, I've got a list of good exe file, and I want to say, give me an alert when on Samba protocol, I've got a file name that is ending with .exe, but is not in this list of a good exe file. So that's another way to do it. So it's just sample, it may not apply, but you can see that you can do some interesting construct when doing matching. So one usage for this is to do IOC matching, because you just need to get a list, for instance, of domain, for example, and then you convert it to Base64, and then you can write a signature for each protocol. For instance, for DNS, you can say the DNS error name has to be, if it is in this set here that I load from this file, then I will have an alert. And you can do the same, use the same list to do the TLS on HTTP using TLS server name indication on HTTP host. And it's not just on domain, because if you have a list of user agent, you can do the same with alert HTTP, HTTP user agent, dataset is set, and you've got the same kind of things. So this is one of the features, but one really interesting feature is that the dataset can learn. So you can, we were talking before about creating the list of HTTP user agent, you can do it, in fact, inside Suricata. So you can just do alert HTTP, HTTP user agent, dataset set in the user agent group that is stored in this ua.lst file. So this way you can construct the list of different metadata that you can see on the network. And one interesting thing is that the output of this is basically the list of patient zero for the metadata. So if ever you have an IOC that comes 6 months later, if you keep this data and say, so this HTTP user agent is bad, but you know it a few months later, you can just go back to this alert where you have a learning set to say, oh, first hit I've got on my network was on this one. And you don't need to keep all the HTTP requests. This is a really small volume database to work with this data. And when it gets interesting is that you can do combo. So you can do a combo where you say, I want, for example, to load the Alexa 1 million top domain list, and then construct the list of user agents that are seen when not going on the top 1 million agent list. So basically, it's the exotic user agent. So you can do this kind of construct simply with this signature that's quite interesting. And one other feature that is, I don't think, well known is that Suricata has a unique socket that you can use for interaction. So you can use it to send command, get information about the running Suricata, and update some data inside the detection engine or various parameters of Suricata. For dataset, we have two commands in the version 6, and we will have going to have a few more commands in the version 7 of Suricata that is coming this year. On this command, our dataset add and dataset remove. So you can, in fact, use an external tool to change the list of IOC when Suricata is running. So you don't need to stop it. You don't need to do a big rules reload that is a costly operation. You can just change live the list of the IOC on the system. So we work with Sébastien Larinier on a software we call Yosemite that is meant to be able to get some information from MISP and inject them directly into Suricata. So the concept is that MISP is able to publish feeds of IOC on various metadata like domain, HTTP user agent, TLS SNI, stuff like this. And we can use this and use Yosemite to transfer live the new IOC to a running Suricata. So how does it work? We've got MISP, we've got Yosemite that fetch from the REST API the information and use the Unix socket to send the information to Suricata. We can use Redis or just a single file to then send back the alert and read the alert in Yosemite to do sightings, which means that we can use the sightings capability of MISP to say that we have seen this new IOC on the system and then enhance your protection. As I mentioned before, Yosemite is developed by Sébastien Larinier in collaboration with me on Stamus Networks. It's developed in Python, it's open source, and Sébastien, did you do the release?
Yeah.
Okay, so it's public, and so it's released. And it's available on GitHub at the following URL. So how does it work? So we're basically just using what I did present you on dataset. On metadata. So you have sample signatures that are available that match on DNS, HTTP, TLS, for example. Then we are using the different keyword pointing to the same data set that we are using the state command, which means that Suricata will store on disk and load from disk when it restarts the IOC nodes. And one interesting point is that we are using this in the signature, the metadata field that I showed you before, to say that this alert is a sightings, and the sightings is using this key here, the DNS query error name, or the HTTP hostname. So in fact, when we've got the alert, it allows us to just parse the metadata from the alert, see that in fact it's a sightings, and that this is what Yosemite is doing when parsing the information. It just look at the JSON and see it's a sightings, and know which element it has to extract from the event, and push it to MISP. So how does it work? There is two commands. One command to import the IOC that you need to run periodically, on what command that will follow, in this case, the JSON file that is produced by Suricata and send back the sightings to MISP. The result, we've done some tests, is, for instance, that we got one publication of a really nice IOC, google.fr, and we managed to do the sightings just by sniffing the traffic and connecting to the web. So, I think I've been sure. No, so it's okay. In conclusion, Suricata is not just an IDS, and even on the IDS side, it is able to do a lot of stuff. And it follows this new feature, allow you to do some dynamic construction, complex construction that can help you to fix some problem you have when you are trying to do detection. And what good thing with Suricata is that it's really performant. You can do this at high speed. We have installation at 40G, 100G, so it's really super fast and scales really well. So if you want to play with Suricata, you can just download it from the Suricata website, and or you can use Sales or some other distribution that allow you to just have a full stack working directly. And the Yosemite, it's published here, and you can play with it. Thank you and bon appétit.
Thank you. So do you want a workshop next year? Yeah, okay. No? Oh. Okay, you make me run.
One question here.
No beer for you.
Hi. I would like to know if you have this learning data set, do you need to reload Suricata, that it also matches on the new entered values into the data set, or?
No, in fact, I can show you the run here. It would be here. So in fact, we just issue import command. Where is that? Okay, I don't see it. I got it before. Yeah, here like this. We just output dataset add command from Yosemite to Suricata on the new field in the IOC. Just added instantly, so we don't need to restart the Suricata. So we can, in fact, I think we could improve Yosemite a little bit to just run directly, and as soon as we got something in MISP, it fetch it and it send it to Suricata. That's really the target here.
Cool. Thanks.
One more fan.
I'm just wondering the maximum amount of bandwidth that that Suricata can handle. I'm having a hard time finding proper statistics.
Yeah, so we've done tests at 100G, and it was working quite fine. 14G, under 10G, it's okay if you can access directly to the hardware. I mean, it's some tuning. Tuning for 40G is complicated. Tuning for 100G, you really need to think about it.
Did you make any comparison between Zeek? Is it faster?
So Zeek, we have some comparison with Snort. We are really faster. And with Zeek, I think we are really faster too. Because the problem also you got with Zeek is that it's not multi-threaded, so you need to run a lot of them in parallel and do the setup yourself, so it can be complicated.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, one, two, three. Okay, thank you.